Welcome again to our fourth event in the series about Israel Contemporary Prospects of Domestic Politics, Foreign Policy, Terrorism, hosted by Henry Jackson Society. The previous events are available on the Henry Jackson Society website and the YouTube channel. I'm Dr. Gadi Ishayahu, and I'm a visiting lecturer in the University of London and a senior consultant to Israel's decision-making units in the field of foreign policy crisis, security and strategy, and I'm honored to lead this event. I know that some of you are wondering, where is my colleague Dr. Burcu Özcelik? But unfortunately, she won't be able to join us tonight as she tested positive for COVID. So Burcu, I know you are watching us and we are wishing you a speedy recovery, and we're looking forward to seeing you soon. I'm also honored to introduce my friend, my other discussant, Dr. Yaniv Voller, who is a senior lecturer in the Middle East politics at the University of Kent. Before that, he was a Levelham Early Career Fellow at the School of Social Political Science, University of Edinburgh. And in 2018 and 19, Yaniv was also a Conflict Research Fellow at the Conflict Research Programme at the London School of Economics and Political Science, supported by the DFID and the Social Science Research Council. He received his PhD from the London School of Economics and Political Science, where he also taught courses in the International Relations and International History Department. Yaniv's research broadly concerns the geopolitics of the Middle East, the foreign policies of the Middle Eastern states, separatism, insurgency, and the role of ideas, ideology, and practice in shaping international politics. He's the author of two books, The Kurdish Liberation Movement in Iraq, From Insurgency to Statehood, and The Second Generation of Liberation Wars, Rethinking Colonialism in Iraqi Kurdish and Southern Sudan, from Cambridge University Press, 2022. His articles are appeared in International Affairs, Democratization, The Middle East Journal, and the International Journal of Middle East Studies. As Israel grapples within significant challenges, both domestically and regionally, with evolving of multi-domain threats posed by Iran and its proxies, Hezbollah and Hamas, tonight we will explore the latest strategy thinking in the Israeli Defense Forces, the IDF. We are honored to host our distinguished guest, Brigadier General Eran Ortal. Part of the fact that Eran is also a friend, Eran is the commander of the Dado Center for Interdisciplinary Military Studies, or the IDF think tank. Eran is also a founder of the Israeli Defense Force Dado Center's journal, Ben Aktavim, dedicated to operational art and military transformation. Eran's published work focused on operational planning and IDF's force design at the general director level. He is the author of the book, The Battle Before the War, that was recently published. He also co-authored an article, along with General Tamir Yadai, arguing that since Operation Accountability in 1993, the IDF has pursued de facto a doctrine that calls a deterrence operations paradigm. Eran and Yadai argue that the reasons for the emergence of this paradigm are the rise of standoff fires capabilities, a perceived reduction in the relevance of the battlefield victory idea, and a parallel rise in the belief of the coercion and punishment approach against state actors. Ortal and Yadai claim that this paradigm has failed and does not achieve its aims. They propose a conceptual and a practical framework to restore the battlefield victory approach in the IDF. In recent years, Ortal adopted the approach to deal with the challenge of missile-based terror armies like Hezbollah and Hamas. In a series of articles, he stressed the strategic significance of rocket threats on Israel and the imperative of developing a new offensive approach to defeat a new threat. Eran also analyzed other core issues in the IDF has dealt with recent years, including ground maneuver, the rockets threats, and the IDF learning and transformation system. His critic of the IDF general staff force design system and strategic learning system led to practical change in the general staff, including the formation of a new organizations, Ortal played a role in strategic thought process in the military intelligence directorate and in the ground forces. Both proces describe a critical evaluation of performance of these ARIs, considering change and offer solutions based on a potential in the changing world, especially in technological development. But I would like to return to you, Eran, and concentrate on your article, Wearing Out the Iranian Tiger, where you argue that Israel is unquestionably a powerful country, but with all the strength, it is still not a regional power. And I would please like you to elaborate about this perception of yours, about the positionality in Israel in the region.
Thank you, Gadi. It's a pleasure to be here. Thank you, Anil, for having me. Yes. First of all, we need to recognize that there is a discussion about whether Israel is a regional power or is not. And one might may ask, why is that question important? For me, it starts with the framework of strategic competition, which the question of whether we are or are not a regional power lies within. And my argument will be that the very framework of strategic competition is a wrong one. What do we and the Iranian compete for or about? Israel, unlike Iran, has no ambitions, has no will, actually no potential or capability to project any of its ideas to the region, not in the religion section, not in the economical, not in the ideological, not in the political order. So we do not really compete with Iran about anything. But the other way around is very true. The Iranians do have the ambition and the capability, the will and the action, and that's their actual aim, to enforce their own ideology and sort of political and economical order in the region. So it's not a matter of two regional powers competing each other. It's a very basic situation of an aggressor and, yes, a powerful nation, but on the defense. And that's why I don't think that regional power is a concept that helps us to grasp the strategic situation.
So in that sense, in an article that I've written lately about Israel's positionality in the region, I would argue that Israel indeed meets the criteria and the characteristics of a regional power. In this context, I've analyzed Israel's decision-making perception about Israel's status in the region. Surprisingly, I've learned that since 2010, Israel's prime ministers Netanyahu, Bennett, Lapid, its defense ministers Yaalon, Barak, Lieberman, and Gantz all perceived Israel as a regional power, at least as a regional power, if not a security power, a technological power, a high-tech power, etc. But the positionality that emerges through the decision-making unit's perception about Israel indeed is seeking to position Israel as a regional power. And in addition, I've analyzed major leading think tanks in the West and leading journals that actually defined Israel as a power. In this context, the military strength ranking 2022, Newsweek power ranking according to US News, country power ranking, global air powers ranking, and Business Insider all perceive Israel at least at the highest 10% of powers in the world, not in the region. And finally, from a scholarly point of view, Israel is perceived as a regional power, according to many scholars that actually analyzed Israel's positionality, among them Kranza and Meldez in 2021, Beck and David Ottaway in 2022 from the Wilson Center, that argued that the four emerging regional powers, Saudi Arabia, Turkey, Iran, and Israel, are all in search for new allies for their respective causes, even as they try to figure how they will deal with each other in the less confrontational manner. And I agree with you that eventually it's about the confrontation with Iran, regardless to the definition. So I would please want to hear your approach about the strategy and the gap in the strategy that exists in the IDF today.
Okay, so let me start, and then, of course, you will maybe point for some gaps in my answer, and we'll follow from that on. As you've opened, there's no argument between us that Israel is a powerful nation, militarily, economically, technologically, a thriving nation, a nation that I'm very proud to represent here. But again, the question of regional power is a contextual question. Now, as I see it, in order to be a regional power that can really compete with the other aggressive power in the region, again, Iran, you may want to ask the questions, these kind of questions. What is your capability to project power? Israel, the IDF, was built as a territorial force. So we've always been excellent in exploiting the advantage of fighting in inner lines with fast and capable ground maneuver supported by good intelligence and air cover. And we could overcome the Arab military army's threat. But today, this territorial force finds itself in a confrontation with a very far away nation that's 1,200 kilometers from our border, and then it might be another 1,000 kilometers to the target area. And yes, the Israeli Air Force can reach these kind of ranges and inflict some damage, but hardly you can call that a power projection of a regional power. Now, again, it's the context. So let's ask the other way around. What is the Iranian power projection capability? Well, they have their proxies armies on our borders. So it's a question of asymmetry. And I think realizing that that Israel is an asymmetric situation, that is not the asymmetric adversaries we were talking about in the last 30 years. That's asymmetry where we are, again, the less fortunate side. So power projection is one theme. The other will be resilience. Iran is a 1,200 by 1,200 kilometers nation. It's bigger than the Ukraine. Population, nearly 90 million people. You can strike Iran, you can inflict damage to Iran, Iran will still be there forever. Look at Israel. It's a narrow strip of land with all the population crowded in it, 20 kilometers but by 100 kilometers long. A few dozen targets, and we're out of business, totally. So being resilient in a conflict is also a part of how can you describe yourself as a superpower. Now again, we are powerful, we have strength, we have many advantages that we can use and utilize in that conflict. But basically, thinking of ourselves as a regional power numbs us. It actually, in my perspective, and you've quoted the article we wrote more than a decade ago with General Yadai and myself, it made us forget the basic truths of Israeli security doctrine, which is, if you have to engage, do it decisively, rapidly, and go back home.
So if I may barge in and ask, first of all, about the last sentence you've said, about the conception that doesn't fit accordingly, based on the previous conception, I would argue, first of all, that Israel has employed several strategies to counter Iran's expanding influence in the region. This includes diplomatic outreach, regional powers, and leveraging in strong military capabilities to demonstrate its commitments to countering Iran's influence. Additionally, Israel has adopted a policy of proactively threatening Iranian activities, such as targeting Iranian backed forces in Syria and preventing the transfer of advanced military technology in Iran. It has also pursued a policy of building closer ties in realpolitik, Bismarck style, with countries in the region, especially the Abraham Accords lately, to build a coalition to push back against Iran. In fact, you said before that these accords are not thanks to the Americans, they're thanks to Iran. Israel, in fact, actually pushed itself because of Iran, coercively. And finally, it had sought an increase in economic and security
cooperation. Don't let me sound ungrateful to the Americans or our sure. previous governments. They all deserve credit, but the Iranians are the first to have that credit. I agree.
I tend to agree. And yet, then, you're talking about a problem with Israel's strategy towards Iran. And when we're arriving to the decisive approach, the decisive battlefield that Israel used to utilize 20, 30, 40, 50 years ago, there's an unmatch. And how can you explain this gap?
Well, maybe to the un-Israeli ear, that might sound paradoxical. Me saying that I don't perceive ourselves as a military regional power, and in the same sentence says that we need to regain our capability to wage decisive battlefield victories. But it's not paradoxical, it's the other way around. Small country like Israel cannot afford to engage in long protracted attrition wars. In order to remain our strength and build the nation and have some kind of normal life, we always understood that we need to decisively remove the operational threat, immediate operational threat. It's not the Arab threat that they used to be, but the immediate military threat from our borders and end the war there. The idea that we now have the advantage, an idea that we have started to, it was actually true from the 90s on, Israeli, mainly intelligence and air superiority, did give us a great military advantage. And we could have afforded back in those days some longer, more protected operations against very weak adversaries like the 1980s Hezbollah in southern Lebanon or the early 2000s Hamas in Gaza. But that is not longer the case. The case is that those two actors are now a fully Iranian proxies. And they are no longer small asymmetric adversaries. They are artillery and ballistics, unstate military forces with a strength that many of the regular armies in the West would have wished to have. And they have tens of thousands of projectiles, including PGMs, directed not only on our cities and towns, but also on our infrastructures and our military forces. The Americans would have described Israel as a nation that lives within the A2AD bubble. A2AD, anti-access area denial, it's a military phrase that basically means that we live in the age of long-range direct fires, and that is threatening every military capability and superiority that we have enjoyed in the last decades. Now, you were talking about the Israeli strategy, and I think all of the themes, the trends of Israeli strategy that you've mentioned are good and valuable and going with the right direction. If I'm being critic, I'm being critic of ourselves, of the IDF. And unfortunately, we have yet to build, to reinvent ourselves in order to be able, to be capable enough to back Israeli strategy with the correct operational military force.
And how would you define the correct? Obviously, you won't talk about secrets here, but how would you define the grand strategy of Israel, the correct grand strategy? How would you describe the next war between Israel? Obviously, we're not expecting one and we don't want to intervene in one, but the next war with Iran and its proxies, it's happening right now. Every day we're hearing about minor events that are expanding. And obviously, in the context of the Iranian strategy to join Russia, things have changed here in Europe and the West and enabled Israel to in fact expand its operational theme towards Iran. How would you describe this event that is climbing up, the climax of it?
Well, first, to refer to your last part, it is unfortunate, of course, that the Ukrainians have to be the ones who pay the price for all of us in the West being awakened to see the Iranian negative role in the world. But that's the way it is. Now, you were asking about the Israeli strategy and the operational capability that I'm talking about. First, let's understand the Iranian strategy. What is their approach? The Iranians are trying to reach hegemony in our region, and they do that with a systematic, slow, slowly building more and more bases in the region, which are sort of umbrellas. One base is backing the other and overlapping the next one, and of course the ultimate umbrella will be the nuclear capability. And in doing that, they're actually implementing a strategy of intimidation. Let's look at the war in Yemen. So when it goes bad, a few PGMs are hitting the Emirati airport, and so war is limited in favor of the Iranian proxies. It's a strategy of intimidation. And that means that operationally, if you want to back Israeli strategy in the operational level, what you need is the capability to not only defend yourself against long-range fires, but the capability to overthrow, remove the threat of those long-range fires and gain the initiative. Because like one of the smart papers that was published by CSIS in the United States, you will never have enough interceptors just to sit and play catch. And as long as we're engaged in long-range fires, exporting projectiles from one to another, that leads to a war of attrition.
Yeah.
And I was referring to that. That is the last thing that Israel can withstand. That is the last sort of competition you want to compete with a huge nation like the Iranians. Another piece of the Iranian strategy is to make sure that war doesn't touch Iran itself via proxies. Some will say that means that you need to build capabilities to directly engage with Iran. I agree with the capabilities part. You need to have the capabilities to directly engage Iran. That's because the best way to prevent a war is to be prepared for one. But realizing the asymmetry between Israel and Iran, I think that Israeli strategy could benefit from learning the Cold War. Now, the prophet, the theoretical prophet of the Cold War, in my eyes, was George Kennan, with his idea of aggressive containment. What was that idea? The idea was that the United States, though unlike Israel, was the stronger actor in the Cold War.
Yeah.
But still, the United States did not want to go to direct war with the Soviet Union for obvious reasons. And therefore, the idea of containment was, let's let the Soviets expand themselves in the world. Let's stop them in their attempt to expand, and let time consume that regime with all its internal flaws.
So the time element is actually the adjusting part of Israel towards Iran. The wall stands together.
Exactly. I mean, it may sound new, but actually I'm just singing the very old songs of Israel security doctrine, because we've always realized that small Israel will never change the region. The basic hostility towards us will not change, maybe in a matter of decades. So the whole concept of quick, decisive battlefield victories was a part of a larger idea that we call the Iron Wall. Well, let's build an iron wall around us, and one day the other side will give up his attempts to throw us to the sea. Basically, let's outlive the enemy. And I think this approach is even more valid when you're thinking about the conflict with Iran. If you had the advantage of ground maneuver and inner lines when you fought the Arab coalitions, well, now you don't have this advantage. And actually, our disadvantages, as I've said earlier, are even more profound than they've used to be. So outlive the adversary is the basic idea of our strategy.
Thank you for that. Yaniv, please.
First of all, thank you so much for inviting me, Gadi. I'm really excited to be here. I'm definitely, my expertise in Israeli strategy is dwarfed by General Otar's expertise, obviously, and yours as well. But I have studied and investigated proxy wars, and I do wonder. So I do have a few questions. The first is, do you think that targeting and attacking proxies would actually help Israel to prevent deterioration into a regional conflict? And if so, what proxies should Israel target? Obviously, the nearest proxy to Israel is Hezbollah in Lebanon, and Israel has also targeted proxies in Syria. But Iranian proxies are spread across the region, right? We can actually go as far as Iraq, and Iraqi pro-Iranian or Iranian-backed militias in Iraq have also been involved in targeting Israel. So do you think that Israel has the capability and the need to actually target these proxies? I do have another question that kind of builds up on that, if I may. Can Israel actually employ a similar strategy to Iran? Can we actually identify proxies can the Israeli government identify proxies that it can use against Iran to create a war of attrition on the Iranian borders? And when I'm asking this question, I'm thinking about Israel's historical strategy, the alliance of the periphery. Right? So if you go back to the 1950s, 60s, Israel trying to create an alliance on the margins of the Middle East with actors such as the Kurds in Iraq, the South Sudanese rebels in South Sudan, and other similar actors. Do you think that we can actually try and revive this strategy?
Well, that's two big questions, Yaniv. Thank you for that. Let's start with the targeting piece. Well, the last thing I want to be understood as one who advocates or calls for war. I'm not calling for war. I'm not calling for targeting our proxies. Again, the idea is that the best way to prevent a war is to be prepared for one. And the whole conflict, which I don't like to call a competition, as I said earlier, between us and the Iranians, is limited because of the framework of the world to come. Everyone limits themselves, and our strategic maneuvering flexibility also lies within our expectations of what's going to happen in the next world. So, no, I'm not calling for initiative to target a proxy. But if you ask yourself, what is the biggest limit on Israeli freedom of maneuver in the strategic level, it's the proxy in Lebanon. It's Hezbollah. Now, it's true. Missiles and UAVs can now be launched from anywhere in the region into Israel. But there's a huge difference between Israeli very capable defenses to intercept 1, 2, even 100 projectiles coming from Iraq, Yemen, and elsewhere, than to try to defend yourself from these threats in the context of full-scale war with Hezbollah, which now will also launch its tens of thousands of projectiles into the same cities and targets. This kind of threat is meant by the other side to overwhelm our defenses. So, and that cannot be changed. Geography and ranges still count, even in our days. So if you're located in our northern border, 40 kilometers from the major city of Haifa, there's things that you can do and no one can do from Iraq or Yemen. That's basic truth. And therefore, the focal point should be the capability to remove Hezbollah threat. If you have that capability to do that swiftly and aggressively and efficiently, then probably you can prevent the war from coming. The other side will realize that your freedom of maneuver will be regained. You could be more aggressive in containing the Iranian threat in all the areas of the region, including force build-up attempts in Gaza and Lebanon, and the situation is changing. So again, it comes back to the operational capability of, again, taking the war to the other side, as we've used to do in the past, take it to the other side, take the war from the skies of Haifa to the hills of southern Lebanon, remove the threat, go back home, and make sure the other side realizes that its capabilities are no match to ours. That's with the first question. Now, the other is about the idea of the alliance of the periphery. First, it's a very good historical analogy because back in the 50s and 60s, we had all these kinds of connections. The Arabs were our enemies, so the outer ring were our friends. That included the Iranians and the Turks and many African nations, and yes, the Kurds also, and some other actors. No one thought of us as a regional major power because we had this kind of connections. So the very fact that we have now a new refreshing connections with Arab nations should not make us think of ourselves in wrong, in my idea, in wrong dimensions today. But it also highlights the asymmetry that I was talking about. One can have good relations, and I don't know the nature of our relations today, with actors like the Kurds, some actors in Mid Asia, and so on and so forth. But the Jewish nation will never have proxies in the region. The Kurds were never our proxies. They were Kurds. We helped them. It served our interests. But we will never have forces like Iranians have Hezbollah and Hamas and others. That simply cannot happen. I think it does not need explanations. That cannot happen. We can have mutual interest with some Arab states in the Gulf. We will not, and they know that, I'm sure of that. We will not send Israeli troops to help them, and they will not fight for us. We will all fight our own wars, and we can help each other with technology and economics and maybe even ballistic missile defense. But that's the glass ceiling of those connections. So again, it's another angle of the basic asymmetry that I think is the more powerful idea from which to explore the strategic situation in our region.
Thank you for that. Yaniv, you have any?
Okay, I do have one more question. And yeah. I think it's just to touch upon the elephant in the room, right? I think quite a few people have been following the events in Israel in the past few weeks and the political tensions that have risen. And I was wondering, I know it's just started, but I was wondering if you think that this might actually have any implications on Israel's strategic planning.
Well, naturally, as a officer in uniform, I will not comment on domestic politics, but I think it's obvious that our enemies are looking with satisfaction to what's happening in our domestic politics. And I do have some grim thoughts about the fact that if you look at the whole, most of Western democracies have gone so polarized in not only politics, but societies. And it is concerning. And yet, the other day, I'm in London, so again, I took the Churchill War Room tour. I always like to be there, it's inspirational. And it reminds us that in the 30s, the democracies were as polarized as they are now, if not even worse. And Prime Minister Churchill still thought that this is a civilization worth saving. I have this confidence that free democracies and the free world is still more resilient, and we will find a way to make ourselves coherent enough again. We're liberal, we're not a very coherent societies, but coherent enough again, and they can enjoy the moment, their adversaries. But at the end of the day, the inner faults, the domestic faults, I think, are much stronger on their side. Historian Paul Kennedy asked the question of how superpowers in history rise and fall, and mainly fall. He asked the question, why do they fall? And one of his main answers was overstretched. They overstretched themselves. That goes to our beginning of the discussion. Israel has no aspiration, no will, no potential to influence the region in those kind of dimensions. The Iranians think of themselves as empire, and they overstretch themselves. And if you ask me, what is the basic idea of Israeli strategy of sort of Cold War? Let's let them overstretch themselves. If we can help them some, let's do that also and outlive them.
Thank you for that. Thank you. If I may ask, before we let some questions from the audience, I would like to finalize one more issue that is regarding to the contemporary situation and the ramification of the Russian-Ukrainian war, and how you perceive, as a strategy thinker in the IDF, the changes in the battlefield. How would you perceive what's happening right now?
Thank you for that question, because without getting into a much more complex conversation on military details of the war in Ukraine, I think what we see in the Ukraine is a very good example of the operational fact that we live in an age of fire dominance. So war is stuck, and maneuver is very hard. Artillery, again, is the queen of the battle, supported by new PGMs and air sighting that makes artillery even more lethal than it used to be. And of course, all those new, more precise weapons.
That is obviously challenging the role of the armor.
That is
in the modern,
and yet,
going back to
and yet,
trenches of
and
first
yet,
war.
Because the war is about territory,
yeah.
One cannot, and that was our mistake. We thought maybe now we can have some wars fought from the standoff point,
yeah,
from only from the air. And you can see the Ukrainian desperate call for armor. So you can see that in the Ukraine, and one can say, well, if this is the reality, one needs more fires. And between the two world wars, some military theorists thought, well, this is the age of artillery dominance. Let's dig ourselves in and build some more artillery. And the other side was thinking, we are living in the age of artillery dominance. We cannot have a valid strategy in that kind of environment. Let's solve that problem. So they've built panzer divisions,
yeah,
and maneuvering warfare. And so I'm with the second school, not being, of course, on the side of the German Wehrmacht. I think this is an operational problem that we need to solve. The key is in the creation of an operational capability, which I call DEM. DEM means data-enhanced anti-fires maneuver. The capability of defeating the other side's fires from a stand-in position, using the proximity of Israel to most of the launching sites, the mass of them on our borders, in order to not only defend our cities in Haifa's and Tel Aviv's skies, but take the war to the other side, intercept what is needed to be intercepted on the enemy's territory, but mainly strike the launchers themselves as they launch their fires in very, very short times, and therefore dramatically limit the enemy's capability to overwhelm our defenses with those mass salvos.
So that's a big shift in Israel's strategy. That would be a big shift and a huge change in this capability of striking, fast striking within the opening of the war. Would you agree with this argument?
It is a big conceptual change that ties the ideas of very rapid strikes and anti-fires fire with the idea of proximity to the other side. What we've been trying to do in the last 30 years is to do that from a standoff position.
Yeah.
And we actually, I think the IDF is one of the best targeting machines in the world, both from intelligence perspective and accuracy and good intelligence, and from the air power perspective. The thing is that the other side have grown accustomed to this kind of warfare. And as well as we have become in targeting the other side, he has become rather excellent in avoiding being a target. And now when once he also has precision munitions, we are a much better target bank than they are. And this this situation, this deadlock, need to be breached, need to be overturned by our side.
Thank you for that. Thank you very much. Yaniv, if you want to ask one more question.
I've asked all of the questions that I had in mind, but thank you so much for ending your for sharing with us a more optimistic note about the future of liberalism and democracy in Israel and elsewhere.
So in that sense, I would like to address some of the questions that were posted by the audience. And obviously, I would let some questions here in the room. So at what level of provocation is it necessary to strike against Iran? This is one of the questions.
Well, again, I'm not a decision maker, and I do not make policy. But as I said, in my perspective, a valid strategy from our side will be to avoid direct conflict with the big actor of Iran as far as we can. And of course, there are limits to that. And nuclear capability is that red line.
And it's arriving quite soon, according to the head of the CIA. They have arrived to an 84% of...
Well, nuclear capability is something that can be peeled off with many layers. It's about enrichment, it's about weaponizing, and so on and so forth. I don't want to open here the question of where is exactly that red line should be. But basically, just like George Kennan thought of the Soviet Union, it is not, I think, Israeli interest to go into a direct conflict above or below that red line. And the thing is about the Iranian strategy that you must realize that the provocations will not be from Iranian per se. One of the Iranians' most basic ideas is to make sure that war does not reach Iran. They are under the trauma of 1988, the scuds on Tehran that finished the Iraqi-Iranian war. They would, I don't think they would initiate a kind of conflict that directly goes to the territory of Iran. So practically, we can defend ourselves from small provocations, but if the red line comes in Iran itself or with the proxies, then, as I've said, the cornerstone of our operational capability should be removing the threat from Lebanon in order to open all other strategic veins that we need.
Okay, thank you very much for this answer. One more question before I let the audience here ask. What scope is there for a greater Israeli involvement in the pan-European projects, especially in the aftermath or with the ramification of or the context of the Russian-Ukrainian war?
Well, that's a matter of Israeli policy. And what I can say about that is that I believe that at least sympathy and empathy and the feeling of where do we belong is growing as this war goes on and on.
Okay, thank you for that. And please, if yes.
Yeah, could you? Thank you very much. That's absolutely fascinating presentation. Can you elaborate a bit more on this concept of victory on the battlefield, please? Is this purely an Israeli thing, or is it applicable elsewhere? Because this seems to be something the British Armed Forces, the British Army in particular, seem not to have at the moment.
Well, I think it is an Israeli concept. Actually, one of our more basic concepts. It goes back to not the 50s and even before Israel was created, and it has to do with the idea of asymmetry. So Israel will never be victorious regarding Egypt or Syria. We will not make Egypt or Syria go away. We will not even be able ever never to destroy their militaries and live long ever after. So the decisive battlefield victory means that we will be capable to take the war quickly to the other side because of the lack of strategic depth in Israel, and quickly destroy or destabilize the operational system that threatens us immediately. That is, in the old days, the Egyptian army in Sinai, or the Syrian army in the Golan Heights. That's it. And therefore, take out their capability to go on with that offensive and gain 5 or 10 years break in order to go back to the main point of building a new nation. Going back to these days, we now have to reshape this idea to be capable not only against the old armored Arab armies, but against those missile and PGMs entities built on our borders. So you need to take the war to the other side. That's an old idea. You need to get it done quickly. But the new thing is, how do you stop the fires, which are spread everywhere? And that's the thing that we have to reinvent. I've called it turn on the light, extinguish fires approach. And actually, it is in my book, and it's also on an article I've published in War on the Rocks, if I remember correctly. And you can go and learn more about it there. Yes, other questions from the audience? Okay, sure.
This is a far more broad-ranging one. Do armies still need tanks?
Well, that's a good question. On the one hand, tanks are the perfect targets for
Yes.
those shoulder missiles and the quadcopters and UAVs and loitering munitions. On the other side, And the Amazon, UAVs, yeah. I've just said that in order to remove the threat, we will need a stand-in approach to battlefield. So I don't think we can throw out the idea of platforms, but I do think that platforms need to be operated within a protected environment, which goes back to extinguish the fires. So if you're very capable, if you have enough sensors up and around you, and you are very skilled in detecting the enemy, if not before it fires, so at least in the minute that it fires, and if you're close enough and aggressive enough with directing rapid and very accurate fires back to his launching site, then what you've created is actually quite a good a system of force protection. And not force protection like our advanced protections of the single platform, but a force protection that covers a big area of maneuvering.
So that is not only much more aggressive, but also way more economical, affordable. You can do that. You will never have enough protections going to imply them on each and every single platform.
Yeah.
And even if you do, who brings the fuel for that platform? The logistics, of course. And the shells and the artillery shells and so on and so forth, you will never have enough single point protection. So you will need to have an environment which is protected by this aggressive sensing and striking capability.
Thank you. I would like to thank you, General Brigadier Eran Ortal, for a great evening. Thank Dr. Yaniv Voller for helping me in participating in this event. You would find this event on available on the HJS website and the YouTube channel. I wish you all a great